Bantam Audio Publishing presents a Dell production of The Copper Beech by Maeve Binchy. Shancarrig School. Father Gunn knew that their parish housekeeper, Mrs. Kennedy, could have done it all much better than he could at the Church of the Holy Redeemer in Shancarrig. Mrs. Kennedy would have done everything better, in fact, heard confessions, forgiven sins, sung the Tantum Ergo at benediction, buried the dead. Mrs. Kennedy would have looked the part, too, tall and angular like the bishop, not round and small like Father Gunn. Most people only knew Shancarrig because of the huge rock that stood high on a hill over Barna Woods, and since Carrig was the Irish word for rock, that was how the place was named, Shancarrig, the old rock. Mrs. Kennedy would have thought that in the matter of a visit from the bishop to the Shancarrig school that she, as the priest's housekeeper, should have been in charge of everything. Was it really expected that those lay teachers above the schoolhouse and the children that were taught in it were to be in charge of the ceremony? "They're not used to bishops," said Mrs. Kennedy, implying that she had her breakfast, dinner, and tea with them. But Father Gunn had been adamant. The occasion was the dedication of the school, a bishop's blessing, a ceremony for Holy Year. It was to involve the children, the teachers. It wasn't something run by the presbytery.
"But Monsignor O'Toole is the manager," Mrs. Kennedy protested.
The elderly priest played little part in the events of the parish. It was all done by his curate, Father Gunn. Father Gunn asked God to let the thing be done right, to inspire young Jim and Nora Kelly to keep that mob of young savages that they taught in some kind of control. Whether or not the children were going to be allowed to partake of the feast itself was a somewhat grey area. There would be something, of course, the children knew that, but only when the grown-ups were served. There might be just the duller biscuits when all the iced and chocolate-sided ones had gone.
"They'll have to give some to us," Maura Brennan said. "It wouldn't be fair otherwise."
"Ah, there's no proof that we'll get any," Neil Hayes said.
"We'll help ourselves," said Foxy Dunn.
His friends looked at him round-eyed. He must be mad.
"I'll sort it out on the day," he said.
Father Gunn was not sleeping well for the days preceding the ceremony. It was a kindness that he hadn't heard Foxy's plans. When the day arrived and the bishop emerged from the train, some of the children, dressed in the little white surplices of altar boys, stood ready to lead the procession up the town. They left the station and walked to what might be called the centre of town, had Shancarrig been larger. The bishop paused at the Church of the Holy Redeemer to say a prayer at the altar. Then they walked past the bus stop, the little line of shops, Ryan's Commercial Hotel, and the terrace where the doctor, the solicitor, and other people of importance lived. The first sign of the schoolhouse was the huge ancient copper beech tree that shaded the playground. Then you saw the little stone schoolhouse built at the turn of the century. A crowd of almost 200 people stood around the schoolyard. They were dressed in their Sunday best. The group would part to let the little procession through, and then the bishop would see the children of Shancarrig. They stood, all 48 of them, outside the school. They looked like little angels, Father Gunn thought. It was always a great surprise the difference a little cleaning and polishing could make. The ceremony went like clockwork. It was almost time for tea, the most splendid tea that had ever been served in Shancarrig. All the eatables were kept inside the school building, and when the last notes of the last hymn died away, Mr. and Mrs. Kelly withdrew indoors to get them. Father Gunn decided to go and help. Quietly, he moved into the school to find a scene of total confusion. Mr. and Mrs. Kelly and young Madeline Ross, who was going to try for the post of junior assistant mistress with them the following term, stood frozen.
"What is it?" Father Gunn asked, barely able to speak.
"Every single queen cake,"
Nora Kelly held up what looked from the top a perfectly acceptable tea cake with white icing on it, but underneath the sign of tooth marks showed that the innards had been eaten away.
"And the chocolate cake,"
gasped Madeline Ross. The front of the cake looked delectable, but the back had been propped up with a piece of bark, a third of the cake having been eaten away.
It's the same with the apple tarts.
Nora Kelly's tears were now openly flowing down her cheeks.
That foxy Don, I should have bloody known.
Jim Kelly's face was working itself into a terrible anger.
The little bastard said he'd help with the chairs, brought a whole gang in with him.
Stop saying bloody and bastard to Father Gunn, said Nora Kelly.
I think it's called for, said a grim Father Gunn.
It's all ruined,
Madeline Ross said.
It's ruined.
Of course it's not ruined, said Father Gunn, coming to his senses. Get the teapots out. Call Mrs. Kennedy to help you. Get Connor Ryan from the hotel to start pouring the lemonade and send Dr. Jims to me as quick as lightning.
Madeline was out the door in a flash. The doctor arrived, worried in case someone had been taken ill.
It's your surgical skills we need, doctor. You take one knife, I'll take another, and we'll cut up all these cakes.
Triumphantly they arrived out with the plates full of cake selections, since most people might not have felt bold enough to choose such a wide selection. They were pleased rather than distressed to see so much coming their way.
Out of the corner of his mouth, Father Gunn kept asking Mr. Kelly, the master, for the names of those likely to have been involved. Smiling as he served people, he repeated as an incantation, Leo Murphy, Eddie Barton, Neil Hayes, Maura Brennan, Nessa Ryan, and Foxy Bloody Dunn.
As the gathering neared its end, Father Gunn assembled the criminals together in the school. Correct me if I have made an error in identifying any of the most evil people it has ever been my misfortune to meet, he said in a terrible tone. Their faces told him that his information had been correct.
Mr. Kelly is a man with large hands, said Father Gunn. He has declared his intention of using them to break your necks. However, I told Mr. Kelly that you had all volunteered to wash every dish and plate and cup and glass, that you would pick up every single piece of litter that has fallen around the school.
There was silence.
When other bad deeds are hard to remember, Father Gunn went on, this one will always be to the forefront of the mind. This June day in 1950 will be etched there forever.
He could see that Eddie Barton and Maura Brennan's faces were beginning to pucker. He mustn't frighten them to death.
So now, he said, you will join the guard of honour to wave goodbye with your hypocritical hearts to His Grace, whose visit you did your best to destroy. Out! He glared at them. Out! This minute!
Outside, the bishop's party was about to depart. The bishop was moving from person to person, saying that it did the heart good to get out to see God's beautiful nature from time to time. What a wonderful tree this is! He looked up at the copper beech as if to thank it. And what's all this writing on the trunk? Father Gunn heard the Kellys' intake of breath. This was the tree where the children always inscribed their initials, complete with hearts and messages saying who was loved by whom. Too secular, too racy, too sexual to be admired by a bishop. But no, the bishop seemed by some miracle to be admiring it.
It's good to see the children mark their being here and leaving here, he said. Like this tree has been here for decades, maybe even centuries back, so will there always be a school in Shancarrig to open the minds of its children and to send them out into the world.
Father Gunn turned to look once more at the criminals. Because the day hadn't been ruined, he gave them half a smile. They didn't dare to believe it.
Maddie Ross. When Maddie Ross was 18 years old in 1950, there were a great many things lacking in her life, like any plan of what she was going to do, like any freedom to go away and do it.
Her widowed mother needed somebody at home, and her brother had gone out to Rhodesia to live with an uncle who had a farm the size of Munster, so Maddie would be the one to stay. The Rosses had a
small... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.